All the participants who've joined us today, I'm extending a very warm welcome to Dr. John Vinayagam. And it's a real pleasure to have you here, sir. And thank you for taking time this morning to join us. We really value your time. And we're all curious to hear from you about the Tantric Yoga and your journey and your service to the public. I'll start with a few questions to you, and then I think all the participants also would like to hear, ask a few questions at the end of the session. So we can see that you're an allopathy doctor, and how did you enter into Tantra Yoga?
Usually this is the question in every class I face. Actually what happened, when I finished my study, MBBS, from Stanley Medical College, Chennai, I started my practice in 1981 with very high hopes. And I was thinking, I have learned allopathy, so I am going to cure all the diseases. But within a short time, I would say around a year, I found that it's not possible to cure everything with allopathy.
Recording in progress.
So, initially I thought my knowledge is limited in allopathy. So I started referring those cases where I cannot do anything. I referred those cases to my masters, my professors, who taught me the system and who are more experienced. But after 4 or 5 months, they came back to me saying that the thing is the same. For example, a case of cervical spondylosis. If I'm not able to cure it, I send it to my ortho professor. But again, the patient comes back to me. Same problem, same pain, nothing is getting cured. Maybe a temporary relief you are able to give. Eczema, psoriasis. So there are a lot of diseases. But of course, allopathy can do wonders in emergencies. For appendicitis, allopathy is good. For a heart attack, you had to go to allopathy. There's no second thought about it. But these chronic diseases, we were not able to do anything. Then I started searching for any other system, whether there is answers for any other system. So first I learned acupuncture. Then from acupuncture, then within 2 or 3 years, I found that acupuncture also has its own limitations. Then I went to various systems of alternate medicines. I learned Reiki. I went up to grandmaster level in Reiki. Then I learned Sujoka acupuncture, Sujoka therapy, then reflexology, aromatherapy, so a lot of, around 22 types of different modalities I have learned. Finally, I landed up with Tantra Yoga. Once I entered into Tantra Yoga, then I found, yes, this is the answer. Because the basic problem in allopathy is, we know the anatomy, we know the physiology, we know everything. But we never bother about the energy aspect of the body. Emotional aspects, we understand. Psychiatry is a very big field now. If you are not able to fit that patient into any cupboard, medicine or ENT or ortho or anywhere, we put it in the psychiatry. But when I learned Tantra Yoga, then I understood, no, man is not only the flesh and bone. He is more than that. He depends on the life energy. The very life energy, we don't know anything about in allopathy. We don't bother about that life energy. So that life energy, if there is an imbalance, that leads to diseases. So finally, I settled with Tantra Yoga. Still, my breadwinner is allopathy. I'm a practicing diabetologist, very busy diabetologist in Chennai. So, if people come to me for alternate health. Some people, they come reading my books and hearing about me from others. They come only for alternate therapy. Then I treat them with alternate therapy. And even an allopathy, if the patient is known to me or if the patient is susceptible, if he doesn't have any prejudices, I tell them, see, this is psoriasis. As an allopathy physician, I cannot do anything. I cannot give you a complete cure. I can treat you, I can give you a relief, but I cannot cure you. Are you happy with that? Or shall we go try for a cure? If he says, okay, I'm ready to try for a cure, then I combine all the systems, all the alternate systems, along with my allopathy. Even diabetes patients, many insulin-dependent diabetes patients, I have taken them out of insulin. Not only with allopathy, allopathy plus other systems, aromatherapy, reflexology, acupressure, acupuncture, mudras, chanting therapy. So there are a lot of the therapies available. Only thing is, we have to analyze and decide. So now I'm very happy I have entered into allopathy. Okay.
It's really interesting to hear that you're practicing a holistic way of...
Holistic
way, and wish each of us learn holistic approaches, not just allopathic or not just Siddha or Ayurveda, but we have to benefit from each and every approach in a holistic way. So thank you for that. And SKY is a non-religious organization, and we don't like to ask any religious questions, but we are curious to know, you, by birth you're a Catholic, and Tantra is based on Hindu philosophies. And how do you explain this? Because we have encountered in sessions when we open up to non-Indian communities, we have experienced questions like, I'm a Catholic, I don't want to be initiated. So we want to know how you got into this Hindu philosophies, and how do you approach it, and how do you explain it? Thank you.
This is also another question. Many people wanted to ask, but they hesitate to ask. I'm happy you have asked that question. I'm a born and practicing Christian, but I don't have any prejudices. But the fact is, Tantra Yoga is not based on Hindu philosophies. It is based on Indian philosophy, Indian thinking, and it doesn't have any religious aspects as such. Later on, it was added on. Basically, it's a science, it's a life science. It is an exact science. We can explain each and everything. There's no mumbo jumbo here, there's no blind faith here. We don't ask you to believe anything blindly. That is the basis for any religion. Any religion, the cornerstone is faith. Unwavering, strong, unquestioning faith. But Tantra Yoga encourages us to ask questions. Don't accept anything as such. Analyze it, experience it, then accept. Because I was trained in allopathy, so my mind is always a scientific one. I'm more oriented towards science. I'm happy with science. And I won't say I am very comfortable with the religion, any religion, even my Christian religion. Any religion, they have some certain rules and regulations. They have a framework. If you are a member of that religion, you have to be within that four frames. You are restricted. You are not allowed to go outside of it. To a certain extent, Hindu religion is a little relaxes. But even then, you cannot exceed a certain limit. In Christians, we are more strict. In Islamic, they are very stringent about their rules and regulations. But Tantra Yoga is not a religion, it's not religious based, It is an exact science. But people unfortunately forgot about the science aspect of that and adhere more into the religious aspect. So I would like to teach, and I am teaching for the past 20 years, Chandra Yoga as a pure science. So, for example, there are many energies in the body. Whatever is outside, it is inside also. That this is the microcosm, that is the macrocosm. So whatever is present in the macrocosm, it is present in the microcosm. That is the basic philosophy. Scientists may, that macrocosm, the energies, we call it as prabhanja shakti or cosmic energy. And scientists, they also accept there are a lot of energies in the cosmos, cosmic energy. They have named it as X-rays, gamma ray, beta ray. So scientists give certain names. We have given some other names. If energy which has the capacity to create, we called it as Brahma. The energy that has the capacity to sustain, we called it as Vishnu. So the energy which destroys and promotes regeneration, we called it as Shiva. So this is only the terminology differs. Basic science is the same. And everyone knows that, even modern science says, energy has two aspects, positive and negative. Chinese people, they called it as yin and yang. We called it as Shakti and Shiva. So without Shakti, there is no Shiva. Without Shiva, there is no Shakti. So it's only the name, only the identification. But science is the same. So only when the Shakti and Shiva unite, the energy is complete. That is basic physics. Only when positive and negative gets connected, the energy circuit is closed. So the energy could act. We say the Shiva is a Shava, that is a static energy. Shakti is the dynamic energy. So if you understand the science behind each and every religious thing, then every religion is based on science. So ultimately, I am focusing on the science aspect of it.
Thank you. It's really wonderful to hear that even religions are based on science, and all along the way, we have lost that connection a bit, haven't we? So it's good to go back to basics, and this leads to more curiosity about learning about what is actually Tantra Yoga. And if you can explain us a little bit more about Tantra Yoga, what is the concept and how we use it, how we apply it, please. Thank you.
So Tantra Yoga is the most misunderstood art, I would say. Because in the West, they have identified it with sex. Tantra, immediately they think it is oriented, sex-oriented. No, it's not so. It's a life science. And the main focus is on health. The Tantra, the main focus is on health. Then, of course, wealth. Then, finally, spiritual evolution or evolution. I won't say it is spiritually. When we evolve further, because evolution is a continuous process, when you evolve further, one day you will reach that God level. That's evolution. So from one cell bacteria, we have reached this stage. Now we are going ahead with evolution. So maybe in another 1 million or 2 million years, we will reach the God state, what we call it as God now, or what are the capabilities we are ascribing to God, we will have. All those things we will have. That is the God level, manidhanam kadavul agalam. So that is the evolution. Tantra Yoga, Tantra as such means shortcut. இந்த வேலையை வந்து தந்திரமாக பண்ணிட்டாயா அப்படின்னு சொல்கிறோம் இல்லையா. ஸோ இட்ஸ் அ ஷார்ட்கட். ஸோ தந்திர கிவ்ஸ் யூ சம் ஈஸி ஆர் ஷார்ட்கட், ஈஸி மெத்தட்ஸ். பை ப்ராக்டிஸிங் தோஸ் மெத்தட்ஸ் யூ குட் அச்சீவ் எவல்யூஷன் இன் அ குயிக்கர் இன் அ ஷார்ட்டர் டைம். You need not have to wait for another 1,000 years or 2,000 years to reach the next level of evolution. So Tantra is basically the science which teaches you how to evolve further without pain and without delay. So instead of taking so many births, within one or two births you can achieve that level. And some may call it as mukti, but I won't call it as mukti, because mukti is easy to get. But even beyond mukti there are other levels, and there says there are so many other higher levels before you become one with the universe or one with the cosmos or one with God, one with Paramatma. So we have so many other steps, higher steps. So Tantra teaches you how to reach those things, or how to reach the top or the maximum evolution with minimum pain or minimum effort. That is Tantra. And you'd be interested to know that every yuga has one shastra, yuga shastra. We call it as yuga shastra for mukti. Every yuga, the first yuga, they had that karma yoga. Karma yoga. You do your karma. You do your work. Kadameyachai balanai edirpaarade. Do your duty. Do your duty sincerely, and at some point of time you will reach mukti. Okay, fine. Then the second yuga came. For the second yuga, the shastra was Bhakti Marga. If you have a strong faith and the bhakti irunda podu, you will reach that mukti level. That is for the second yuga. Third yuga, they had Jnana Marga. Through Jnana, you can reach mukti. But this fourth yuga, Kali Yuga, you cannot reach mukti with the Karma Yoga or Bhakti Yoga or Jnana Marga, because there is a reason behind this. The longevity of the humans in the first yuga, it was somewhere around 1,000 years. People were living for 1,000 years. So they can go through this Karma Yoga, do their karma sincerely for 1,000 years. At the end of that, they will reach mukti. Then in the second yuga, the age of the average age or longevity has reduced to 600 years. Now, you cannot reach that mukti level with one birth, because it needs around 900 to 1000 years. Now the longevity has reduced to 600. So people were trying to find another marga, that was Bhakti Marga. In the third yuga, the longevity was reduced to 300 years. Now in the Kali Yuga, it was around 40 to 50. Now it is slowly going up. Now we can say around 80 to 100. So the easiest way to reach the mukti, or the next step in evolution, within 100 years is Tantra Marga. So what people have done, our ancestors have done, is they have collected all the knowledge, all the previous knowledges. They have evaluated them, and they chose some powerful techniques from each. From Raja Yoga, for Jnana Yoga, for Bhakti. So from everything they have taken, then they have compiled and added something more. Then they have devised this yoga, that is Tantra Yoga. And the beauty of Tantra Yoga is not limited to any any religion or any caste. Even a Shudra can do it. Even a woman can do it. Because in certain previous yogas, most of the yogas and most of the teachings, even Vedas, a Shudra cannot learn. He was not allowed to learn. And women were not allowed to learn. There were so many restrictions. So Tantra Yoga is for the common man, for everyone, for every citizen of the universe, for every citizen of the world. So from the age of 6 years, anyone can do Tantra Yoga, irrespective of their religion, irrespective of their age or gender or their caste. So that is the beauty of Tantra Yoga.
That's really an eye-opener to listen to the evolution of Tantra Yoga and all these yugas and how they are associated with human life. I think the more we listen to you, the more we have questions arise, and I can see participants are starting to raise questions. In terms of like the Kali Yuga, you've told us that we are down to 40 to 50 years, which is slowly increasing. So what is to expect next? What is the next stage that we will be going for, and how would we prepare us for that through the Tantra Yoga?
Okay. Now the thing is, why this age is reduced? And is there any proof to show that the age is reduced? In all of our Puranas, you can see, Dasarath lived for around 900 years. But the clearest evidence would be in Bible. You go through Genesis, the first chapter in the Bible. Adam and Eve, they lived for around 900 to 1000 years. Up to Abraham, it was around 900 years. Then by the time of Noah, it came down to 300. And before that, it was 600. So in Genesis, there is a clear evidence that slowly the longevity has decreased. Even in our pranas, you can find it, but not in one prana. In several pranas, if you collect and if you collate, you can find the evidence. Okay, it is due to some changes in the atmosphere or changes in the universe. Genetic changes has happened, so our longevity has reduced. So Tantra Yoga, and I would like to ask you one question. Who discovered evolution, theory of evolution? Who is the father of theory of evolution? Are anybody in the audience?
Who is I'll open up to audience, so anyone can tell us.
Who is the father of evolution? Charles Darwin is supposed to be the father of evolution. So his period is around 150 years back. So he lived around 150 years back. Okay. So the theory of evolution was discovered 150 years back. Okay. I would like to ask you, there are dasavadaras of Vishnu. What is the first avatara? What is first avatara of Vishnu?
Is it Machcha?
Machcha. Second one? Second Kurma. One? Kurma. Third one? Varaha. Machcha, Kurma, Varaha.
Varaha.
Okay, just think over. What is Machcha? Fish.
Mm-hmm.
So according to modern science and what Charles Darwin proposed, the life originated in water, in sea, as a single cell amoeba. So life originated in water. That is the Machavadara. Then came Kurma, the turtle, which can live in water as well as in land. It can live in water as well as in land. That is the next step in evolution. Macha, then came Kurma. The third one, Varaha, that is the wild boar, which cannot live in water. It has came out of water now. Now it is living in land. That is the third step in evolution. What was the next one? Macham, Kurma, Varaham.
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 Narasimha.
Just imagine that figure. Half man, half lion. Narasimha, head is lion, the torso is human. So from Varaham, the next evolutions happened, and the species, another species, which is half animal, half human. We may call it as our ancestors, chimpanzees. But our ancestors, they have thought it's a Narasimha. Half lion, half human. That is the next step in evolution. Then the next avatara? Balaram.
Vamanam,
okay. Vamanam. So that also, small human. From that, small human has come. Then came Balarama. He was a full human.
I think Parashurama. It's Parashurama, right?
Parashurama.
Yeah, Parashurama. So he was a full human, but he was a ruffian. He killed everyone. He was a warrior. There were no fine qualities associated with Parashurama. He was a brave warrior. He was a fighting soul. So the, our ancestors, next step in evolution. Then came Rama, a refined man, a lovable person, a very knowledgeable person, a very just person. So that is the next step in evolution. Maybe the status we are in now. Then came Krishna, Krishna Avatara. How do you explain Krishna? A jolly person. He is not serious as Rama. He hasn't entered into any fight. He was just the charioteer. Even in Mahabharata, he didn't take part in that war. So he was only a charioteer. He was the advisor. And he was depicted as the gentle soul, loving soul, who loves even the animals and who loves everyone. And everyone loves him. That is the next avatar. So our next step would be towards that. Unfortunately, we are still Parashuramas. Some are still in Varaha. Okay. So, of course, all of us has crossed that Macha and Kurma. But have you become Rama? I don't think so. Okay, yeah. So most of the population still Narasimha. Manidhan Badi, Mirugam Badi, Sendha Saitha Kalavinam, Adhadam Kandakaranga. So that is the status of 90% of the people. They have to evolve further. Further into Rama, further into Krishna. So Charles Darwin is not the father of evolution. He didn't discover evolution. Our ancestors, thousands of years ago, they knew about evolution. Upper part lavarum, pullahi, pundahi, puluvahi, evolution. நீங்க பாத்தீங்கன்னா எல்லா பிறப்பும் இறந்து பிறந்து இழைத்தேனே அப்படின்னு அது முடியும். அப்போ ஐ ஸ்டார்டட் அஸ் ஒரு புல்லு மாதிரி வந்து புழுவாகி உண்டாகி இப்படி ஒரு ஒரு இதோ அவர் அடுக்கிட்டே வருவார். அப்ப மனிதராய், அதுக்கு மேலேயும் சொல்வார், மனிதராய், கணங்களாய், பேயாய், வல் அசுரராய், Apo, even after the human life, there are other forms of life, other planes of existence, higher planes of existence. So mukti in the body vittu ponuna mukti varadu devarathile adu solliranga manidarai adukapiragu kanangalai devarai asurarai adukapiragu dhan devarai adukku meliyum varum okay so this is a continuous process but what tantra yoga does is it quickens the process by easy practices and basically according to tantra yoga evolution is nothing but your evolution of consciousness unarvu nilai how you evolve into a higher level of consciousness we divide it into three animal consciousness human consciousness divine consciousness we are supposed to be in a human consciousness but half of the time we are in animal consciousness half of the time we are at an animal conscious level sometimes we are in human conscious level rarely we enter into divine conscious level very rarely everyone does that the aim of tantra yoga is to lift you up to make you evolve into divine conscious levels and according to tantra yoga each chakra determines a certain type of consciousness so chakras are activated by kundalini your sky yoga is kundalini yoga am I correct
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you, guys. Kundalini yoga. So I would like to ask you, what is Kundalini? Anyone in the audience? Because I don't want to talk. I would like to be an. I would like this to be an interactive session.
We know. We'd like to hear from the participants. Like, what's your understanding of Kundalini yoga? You can unmute and you can answer.
What is your idea of Kundalini? What is Kundalini?
Okay, I think I'm there aren't any volunteers. We don't want this to be a session where they don't give wrong answers.
Wrong is okay.
I'll start and then masters can join. To me, Kundalini is the life force energy concentration, and that's where all the life force energy is concentrated and raising the energy from the Muladhara chakra to the crown chakra so that we can connect with the cosmic energy. So that's Kundalini yoga for me.
Okay. So Kundalini is the life energy. Okay, it is concentrated near Muladhara. Okay. Do you think Kundalini is flowing in everyone?
It is. It's the basis of life and it's there in everyone, but it may not be flowing adequately or it may be stuck in some chakras depending on our karmas and what we do.
Okay. So Kundalini is the life energy and it is the fuel for the chakras. The chakras are the energy creating centers in the body. They are like generators. Okay. Chakras are like generators. They create energy. But for a generator to create energy, the generator needs a fuel. It may be diesel, it may be petrol, it may be something else. But the generator needs a fuel. Like that, every chakra creates energy, but that chakra needs energy to create. It has to run. It has to rotate. So the chakra fuel, the fuel for the chakra is Kundalini. So everyone, in everyone's body, Kundalini is flowing in a very minute amount. If it is not flowing, there's no life. As you said, it's a life force. So But the amount of Kundalini flow is very, very, very minute. So your chakras, they don't operate at their full capacity. They're very dull. In 99.9% of the people, the chakras are active. If you are able to increase the flow of Kundalini, then the chakra will operate at a higher level. When your Muladhara is very slowly rotating, your conscious level is very low. When it gets little more Kundalini, it will start to rotate fast. If it gets still more energy, it will work very fast. So, as the efficiency of the chakra increases through the increased flow of Kundalini, your consciousness level evolves. Most of the people, we live in the Muladhara conscious level. If at all, we are living in the human conscious level. There are seven other chakras below Muladhara. They are the animal chakras. So have you heard of animal chakras?
We thought the lower three chakras are related to human or animal behavior, and as we rise up more, we go to the divine chakra.
According to Tantra, these seven chakras are human chakras.
Okay.
From Muladhara to Sahasrara, these seven are human chakras. Below Muladhara, there are other seven chakras which are described as logas in our prana. Immediately below Muladhara is the Adala. That is the Adala chakra. The lowest one is Padala chakra. There's a saying in Tamil, Ava Adala Padala. அவன் வாழ்க்கையில் கெட்டு போயிட்டான் இல்லது நொடிஞ்சு போயிட்டான்னு சொல்றதுக்கு என்ன சொல்லுவான், அவன் அதள பாதாளத்தில் விழுந்துட்டான். ஸோ அதளம்னா இமிடியட்லி பிலோ முலாதாரம், பாதாளம் தி லோயஸ்ட் சக்கரா பாசிபிள். அப்போ ஹி ஹஸ் ரீச் தட் கான்சியஸ் லெவல். டியூரிங் எவல்யூஷன் வி ஹவ் ஸ்டார்டட் ஃப்ரம் பாதாளா and we have conquered every chakra, we have activated every chakra and evolved, and then became human. We became human when our Muladhara got activated. In chimpanzees, only the Adalam is active. Muladhara not yet activated. Once that Muladhara gets activated, even the chimpanzee will become a human. Okay. So, your consciousness level can go below Muladhara also. When you are angry, ye manusha mari kathre na solro, ye ya nai mari kathre. What does it mean?
Animal behavior.
Animal behavior, because some of the animal chakra is active at that time, not even your Muladhara. Avan nari mari tandravanya, avan tandravan nari mari plan manuva. In a Vishyam, he is operating at a lower level, animal level. So, when we are not behaving as a human, we compare it to animals. So, all of us have animal chakras, all of us have animal chakra consciousness also. But human chakra consciousness should be there. The aim of Tantra Yoga is to lift you to divine consciousness level. So, according to the activity of your chakra, your consciousness level is determined. So, even in Muladhara, you can go to a very high level of consciousness. And above Sahasrara, there are another seven chakras. They are the, again they are called Logas. Sathya Logam varaikkum adhula pogum, Bhulogam, Bhuvalogam, Sorga Logam, appadina oru yedu logam mele. Puranangalla, they describe it as logas. They are the higher chakras above Sahasrara. So you can evolve. You have evolved from Padala to Muladhara. Now our aim is from Muladhara to Sahasrara. Then above Sahasrara, Bhuloka Chakra. Then Bhuvaloka Chakra, Swargaloka Chakra, up to Satyaloka Chakra. When you ascend to that level, that Satyaloka Chakra consciousness, then only you become one with the cosmic. Then only the Jivatma becomes united with the Paramatma, or your individual energy mixes with the cosmic energy. Have you seen that Hollywood film, Lucy?
Yeah. Yeah, so we have some big fans of Lucy in this forum as well. Yeah.
So, what is that concept?
It is to connect with the universal or cosmic energy and even at...
It was not intentional. On the part of Lucy, it was not intentional.
Intentional, no.
It was not intentional. It was accidental. So some drug accidentally got burst inside her. She was used as a carrier to smuggle the drug. And unfortunately, it burst it. So it got mixed up in the bloodstream. What it did was, it started activating brain cells which are previously not active. Which was previously not active. So as the number of cells in the brain started functioning, as the percentage increases, that was the percentage they were showing in the background, 10%, now 15%, 20%, 30%. So as the number of activated cells become more, she started developing ESP, extrasensory perceptions. Whatever we call it as Siddhihal or Riddhihal, it's nothing but the capability of your brain. Duradrishti abdingiradhu oru siddhi abdingirom. You can see from your house in maybe in UK, you can see what is happening in your house in Chennai. That is called Duradrishti. Now technology has achieved that Duradrishti with the TV, television, and your WhatsApp.
Wi-Fi, yeah.
Wi-Fi, everything. So technology has achieved it. Even humans can develop that. It is not a Siddhi if some parts of your brain cells are not yet active. What the neuroscience says now is, at any point of time, humans use only 10% of their neurons at any point of time. But it doesn't mean that the remaining 90 is inactive. Okay. Every part of the brain is alive. Every part of the brain is active. But at any particular point of time, if you are involved doing some maths problem, if you are trying to solve a maths problem, then the area which is needed for that job is activated. It is active. If you are listening to your beautiful song, then some areas in your right brain gets activated. And you appreciate the song. You enjoy that song. So at any point of time, only 10% is active. If it becomes 20%, then your efficiency, the efficiency of your brain becomes double. Nadu thangumaya yosichu paranga ipo enna padi theriyum ettana irunda ettoor game paattu kekkum pattana irunda pattoor game paattu kekkum 10% brain a vache inda aata aadrame if it becomes 20% what will happen? If it becomes 30%, if it becomes 40%. So, Tantra Yoga prepares the person, cultures the person first. First, you have to prepare that person. You have to culture him. அவனை வந்து இன்னும் சாஃப்ட் ஆக்கணும். யூ ஹாவ் டு இவால்வ் ஹிஸ் கான்சியஸ்னஸ் லெவல், தென் ஓன்லி ஹீ கேன் கெட் ஆல் தோஸ் சித்திஸ். வித்தவுட் தோஸ் ப்ரிப்பரேஷன்ஸ், இஃப் சம்படி கெட்ஸ் தட், தே வில் மிஸ்யூஸ் இட். தே வில் மிஸ்யூஸ். தட் இஸ் வை தந்திரி யோகா வாஸ் கெப்ட் அஸ் அ சீக்ரெட், பிகாஸ் இட் ஹஸ் சோ மெனி பவர்ஃபுல் டெக்னிக்ஸ், சிம்பிள் பட் பவர்ஃபுல். So it was not taught to everyone. Only to a selected few it was taught. In a Gurukula, is it possible today to do that? Are you willing to go to a Gurukula to learn Tantra Yoga for 24 years?
I wish the education system was remain that way instead of going behind evidence. And but we need to have a balance of both modern medicine as well as ancient practices. But our ancestors are really, really, I think they had the wisdom to refine the man before they give the techniques. That's evident from what you're listening to, you really. So again, from listening to you, we can see that the aim of Tantra Yoga is preaching divine consciousness, not just mukti alone. And what could be the important techniques in Tantra Yoga?
Okay. Tantra Yoga, we can divide it into three aspects. Tantra, Yendra and Mantra. Tantra, Yendra and Mantra. Tantra means there are so many techniques. It includes mudras, pranayama, some meditation. So the important techniques of tantra is mudra, pranayama, meditation. In tantra yoga, we don't give much importance for yogasanas, postures. Postures, if you are able to do it, is good. It's better. But if you cannot sit in a posture for a very long time, if you are not able to do Padmasana, we don't bother. Okay, sit in a chair. So Tantra Yoga advises, don't strain your body. It should be comfortable, but it should be straight. The body should be comfortable and you should get involved into what you are doing. If you feel sitting in Vajrasana is very difficult for you, will your mind stay on what you are meditating? Your mind would be in your heel. It's paining. So, Tantra Yoga is a very flexible and easy technique. But I used to say in my class, Tantra Yoga is for the lazy boys and girls. But the fact is, intelligent lazy boys and girls. Okay. It is for intelligent people. Because it involves lot of jnana, lot of knowledge. You have to learn everything and you have to understand everything before entering into your practice. Before doing Mula Bandhana, you should know what is Mula Bandhana, why you should do Mula Bandhana, what will happen if you do Mula Bandhana, what will happen if you do it wrong. Because Mula Bandhana is a very powerful technique, but in most of the places, just sucking up the anus out is called as Mula Bandhana. That's not Mula Bandhana. In most of the places, it is taught like that. That is called Ashwini Mudra. If you say that is Mula Bandhana, then what is Ashwini Mudra? So, sucking up the anus inside is Ashwini Mudra.
Ashwini Mudra. And holding it and prolonging the Ashwini Mudra is what we call Mula Bandhana in sky. But we control it with Ojas breath as well.
Yeah, most of the places start like that. But Tantra Yoga is more specific. It is not Mulabandhana. So Mulabandhana is a very, 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 very subtle technique. There won't be much movement in it. Only a pulsation. You will feel only a pulsation on the Kshetra of Muladhara. On the Kshetra. For each and every chakra, we have a trigger point or we have a remote control point. That point is called the Kshetra. So, just stimulating the Kshetra with your mind is called Mulabandhana. Then it becomes very powerful. Sucking up the anus inside is called Ashwini Mudra, because all the horses on earth, they do it.
Yeah.
Why horses are strong? Why
Morning
horses are
muscles.
Lean? They don't have much fat in them. If you look at a horse, there's no fat, all muscle, bone and skin. Their stamina is very great. That Ashwini Mudra, what the horse is practicing throughout the day, it gives that stamina. So by doing that Ashwini Mudra, you will have stamina, you will get energy. But at the same time, your body temperature will increase. Some people, they get piles. Hemorrhoids.
Constipation as well.
Constipation. They develop hemorrhoids. So before entering into that, you have to teach them. And the Tantra Yoga teaches the subtlest technique. With the mind, you have to activate the Kshetra, not the anus. Even in Ashwini, we don't go for that sucking up. Ashwini, only a subtlest movement of the anus with the mind. Activating with the mind. That is Tantra Yoga. So Tantra Yoga, there's no hard or there's no physical work as such. Only in the basic classes we have some physical exercises. Some simple physical exercises. But as you go up and up, second level, third level, fourth level, fifth level, it's more of mental exercises. We bring changes in your brain. We bring changes in your emotions. We try to bring changes in your emotion level, your consciousness level, not at the physical level. When your emotions and consciousness are elevated or cured, then your physical body is automatically cured. So what we advise our students is, first, be healthy. Take care of your health. So, my first level class, this is my own curriculum. I have designed it. My first level class focuses mostly on health. Then on wealth. You may be surprised why we are talking about wealth. Is it against spirituality?
It is. Without self-sufficiency, without basic needs, I think we can't explore in or go into inward journey. If we are longing for food or basic necessities, but human mind doesn't just stop with basic necessities. That's the thing.
Okay. So, first you have to achieve in this life. As you said, self-sufficiency, or even we go further, okay, whatever you want, whatever you would like to achieve in this life, do it. Only when you do everything you wanted, only you have achieved what you were trying to or what was your ambition. First you reach your ambition, fulfill your goals. Then a day will come, you'll start thinking, what next? I wanted to have 2 bungalows, now I have 2 bungalows. I wanted to have 100 sovereigns gold, now I have 200 sovereign gold. I wanted to buy 100 pattu sarees, now my wardrobe has 500 pattu sarees. I wanted to buy a Bentley car or a Rolls Royce. Now I have 3 Rolls Royce. So what next? So when you are fulfilled, then your mind seeks other. What next? Then only you can enter into spirituality. So this life, you have to do first your duties, all your duties. That was the ancient way also. In the ancient times, people first they go to Gurukula, learn everything, then they come out of the Gurukula, even the princes, they go to Gurukula, then they come out, then they get married, then they have a normal life, illaravalkai. Then when their children are grown, when they are settled, then they think, okay, I had enough. I have completed all my duties. Now I will go to sannyasa. So along with his wife, this man will go to forest. That was the way of life previously. After completing all your duties, after achieving everything you wanted to achieve, then you are fulfilled. You don't have any regrets. You don't have any longings. Then you can enter into spirituality fully. So I advise my students, whatever you want to earn, earn it, but in the right way. Not any crooked way, in the right way. Whatever you want to learn, learn it. Whatever you want to earn, earn it. Whatever you want to achieve, achieve it. Tantra Yoga will help you. It will show you the ways. We have some mudras for that also. We have Lakshmi Mudra, we have Kubera Mudra, we have Kubera Mandra, we have Lakshmi Mandra, everything we have. So, Tantra Yoga will help you in that aspect also. First health, then wealth. Okay, now you are healthy, you are wealthy. Will you be satisfied with that?
I don't think so.
What would you like to have next?
I think the
goal of my life.
Your
Why
goal
am I
of,
born?
Pardon?
Why am I born? Meaning of life.
Meaning of life. So it goes. So we enter into another field. Do you have any aim in this life? Or what is the aim of your life? Do you have
aim,
any special aim? Pardon?
Aim can be financial or family, but I wouldn't consider that because I feel that is my karma. As you said, achieving some goals about health and wealth. So I wouldn't consider those as my goals.
Okay, would you consider Mukti as your goal?
I'm not sure. To be honest, when I see the pain around the world, I'm thinking that if I get Mukti, I'm being very selfish. I'm getting rid of this world and I'm just enjoying my life.
No, that is the point. The thing is, we don't push our students or our followers into mukti path. No. Personally, now I'm teaching Tantra Yoga for the past 20 years. I'm doing my clinical practice for the past 41 years. I started in 81, my clinical practice. Now it is the 40 years completed. I have helped so many people in the medical field. Lot of patients I have cured, I have helped. And lot of students I have trained, more than 5,000 or 6,000 students I have trained in Tantra Yoga. So my life is useful to others. I'm happy. I'm not doing it commercially. Of course, I charge fees, but a reasonable fee. And I'm not doing that for the fees, okay? So, I'm happy that I'm useful to a lot of people. If I go towards Mukti, as she said, the other participant said, it shows only as DVG.
It's Deepali. It's Deepali, one of our aspirants from Birmingham.
Okay. As she said, it is very selfish. If I achieve Mukti, only my soul is benefited. Nobody else is benefited. If I reach Mukti, anyone, even my son, will he get any benefit? Even my wife or my students, do they get any benefit out of it? No. But I would like to born again. I would like to born again and again and again. And I would like to teach a lot of people. If possible, I would like to be a doctor in the next birth also. I would like to treat a lot of patients. I'd like to help. That is my mission. So that is the happiness I get. So I don't think Mukti is a goal of Tantra Yoga. No. Evolution, we say evolution. Go further, evolve further, evolve further. Be a better human being. Be a better human being. Because at the end of the Tantra Yoga class, people will ask, Doctor, I'm a smoker. Can I do Tantra Yoga? Okay. From a health point of view, it's not good. Reduce smoking. Do Tantra Yoga. Then another man will ask, Doctor, I'm very fond of meat. I cannot live even one day without meat. Can I take the non-veg food and do Tantra Yoga? Do it happily. You don't have any inhibitions on it. Okay. Then women, sometimes in the class they ask, or sometimes after the class they come and ask, can I do my practices during my monthly periods? No trouble there. You can do that. Okay, what about other theatre? ஒரு சாவு நடந்த வீட்டில் இத்தனை நாளைக்கு தீட்டன் இருக்குது. அப்போ அந்த மாதிரி டைமில் கேன் ஐ டூ மை ப்ராக்டிஸ், யூ கேன் டூ. ஃபைனலி பீப்புள் கெட் இரிட்டேட்டட். ஆக்சுவலி இன் ஒன் கிளாஸ் ஒன் லேடி ஆர் சார், அப்போ என்னதான் சார் பண்ணக்கூடாது? எதை கேட்டாலும் பண்ணலாங்கிறீங்களே, அப்போ நான் என்ன தான் பண்ணக்கூடாது? So whatever you have asked so far is external. It's immaterial to the soul. Whether you take a meat, your soul is not affected. Whether you take a, whether you smoke, whether you drink, it is immaterial. What you should not do is, அடுத்தவன கெடுத்து பேசாத, அடுத்தவன் வாழ்க்கையில மண்ணடி போடாத, அடுத்தவனை பத்தி தப்பா பொருளி கிளப்பாத. போதும், இத மட்டும் பண்ணியா, வேற எதர் பண்ணாலும் தந்திர யோகா தப்பில்ல.
So it's putting introspection, it's applying introspection to human behavior and trying to refine ourselves, isn't it? Yeah. Thank you Deepali, and thank you Doctor. It was a very different perspective to birth and rebirth. I think it made us all think as well. And some of the aspirants are asking some questions, whether we can learn Tantra Yoga online or through distance, like education, like is it possible to learn it online?
I'm conducting classes, and especially after COVID, for the past 1.5 years, I'm conducting classes only in Zoom. So every Sunday I have class in the morning. Every Sunday I have class here.
Mm-hmm.
So, Tantra Yoga classes, we have various levels. The basic level, we divide it into two parts. One is mudras, another one is activation of chakras. Okay. So, that one we can have as a Zoom class, half a day class, morning, your time, morning. 3 hours per day. 3 hours every Sunday we can have, and it will take around 8 days, 8 Sundays. To cover that mudras, basic mudras and tantra. Okay. For an ordinary man, that basic level is enough. It will give you ideas, or it will give you the basic mudras which can keep you healthy. And some mudras which can make you wealthy if you are sincere in your practice. Chakra activation, again it will help you to remove the energy blocks in your chakras, that basic level. The simple techniques, basic level. So for an ordinary man, that's enough.
Thank you. I think that, sorry to interrupt, go on.
Then we have fourth level, and finally the fifth level. Fifth level is actually a training course to make you the next gurus, to elevate you to the teacher level.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a very high level. There we teach a lot of higher techniques and jnana. About Puranas, about Vedas, about Upanishads, all the things.
And you teach all these levels online, or some of the levels are face to face, or?
Most of the thing we can teach online, but only some one or two practices. Sometimes I don't encourage it online, because what will happen when your energy level goes beyond a certain limit? Your body may not withstand it. So people, what they do, they will start rotating. You might have seen those cases in Mahashivaratri. Mahashivaratri, you might have seen every year some people will dance. I'm not talking about the other dances, but the Samyadu. They will start. So it happens. When your energy level goes beyond a certain limit, when your physical body is not able to handle
withstand.
So as a guru, what I do, I immediately stop the chanting. I immediately bring down that energy down so that they are free. So I don't encourage those type of things. It is an adverse reaction. Okay. But unfortunately, in every Shivaratri, our media people will focus only on those who are dancing. So it is an excess energy. I don't encourage that. So only in a personal class. That too, I am very strict. I don't take more than 80 students in a class. That personal classes, not more than 80. Then only I can have a personal eye on everyone. I can watch everyone. I can understand their needs, and I can control the reactions. So I can restrict myself with mostly 80. Online also, I think 60 to 80 is the better thing, not more than that. So only in chanting therapy now I have around 103. Chanting therapy is going on every Mandiri one Sunday. The chanting therapy class now lot of participants, 103, but most of them are my older students.
Okay.
So there's a problem there. Okay. So
that's,
if you're interested in teaching, I'll let you know. I'll.
We would perhaps like to have some information at the after this session about when your classes start, and we're very more than happy to share with our participants who want to learn those techniques as well. And that question came from Srinivasan Palani, and he also has another question for you, whether if you have any particular mudra to prevent common cold and COVID versions of viruses, if there is anything we can do in the form of mudra.
We have. But the thing is that COVID, the basic problem is your immune system is not perfect. Why a particular person gets the disease, another person is not getting. If your immune system is fucked up, if your immune system is active, then your chances of getting that infection is less. In immunity, we have innate immunity and latent immunity. So from childhood, we get a lot of diseases, especially these infective diseases. That common cold is very common during childhood. I'm sorry, there's some construction going in the next building.
Yeah, I think we were wondering whether any of us are unmute or where's the background noise. But sorry,
they asked
yeah,
me to stop okay. For 1 hour. I think they might have watched that 1 hour. Now it's so that 1 hour.
And then they started.
Okay, so that immunity we develop right from our childhood. Before the age of 3, many children, they always have a running nose. They sneeze a lot. They get fever now and then. In a way, it is good because each time they get an infection, their immune system is developed. The immune system is stimulated, they develop antibodies for those viruses and bacteria. So, people from the slum areas, where the children are not pampered, they were not protected, they have very good immunity. Now, our modern life, we excessively protect our children. We don't allow them to go out. We don't allow them to mingle with other children. We don't allow them to play in the dirt. We don't allow them to play in water. We don't allow them even in play in a beach.
Neither do they enjoy the rain, do they? Neither do they enjoy the rain.
Let them enjoy the rain. So, our children, they have a weakened immune system. Weakened immune system. So even now the youngsters, I think around 25 to 30 years, that age, below 30, that immunity is very weak. That is one thing. Because you are overprotected during your childhood. Then the next thing, stress. If stress is more, your immune system is weak. So reduce your stress, okay? Third one. Eat healthy, your immune system would be healthy. These are the three things I would like to insist. So children, let them get cold. What is that? Let them get cold. Let them get fever. They will develop immunity. Protect them from dangers, not from play. Okay. Then eat well, reduce your stress. Get into contact with the earth. When was the last time you walked with your bare foot?
Barefoot.
Just think of it. Barefoot walking. When was the last time you had when you went to the beach?
I think it's these days it's only temples. If we go to temples and even that is difficult.
We are not in touch with the earth. As the cosmos has a lot of energy, the Mother Earth also has a lot of energy. You have chakras in your feet, that Ulangal chakra. So you will receive a lot of energy from the earth. That will strengthen your immune system. Okay. So there are a lot of other ways to strengthen your immune system. But we have mudras also, especially prana mudra. Then we have, as you said, that cold and running nose, linga mudra. Very, very, very effective mudra, linga mudra. You have to do it for 6 to 8 minutes. Within 6 to 8 minutes, your running nose will stop. So that linga mudra. And Brahmara mudra for all type of allergic rhinitis, allergic problems, asthma. We have Brahmara mudra. A lot of mudras we have. And for my students, when that first wave came last year, when the first wave came in Jan, I think, Jan or February 2020, I send them each week. I used to send them on newsletter through the WhatsApp. Do these things to develop your immunity. I think it came for around 12 or 14 weeks. Tanihai? Just a minute, I'll confirm. Tanihai? Tanihai line la irukkeengla?
Yes, sir. Yeah, 12 weeks we can send, sir.
12 weeks are there?
Yeah, ama, sir. 12 weeks mele send.
So it was 12 chapters. So I have concentrated on food, mudras, some breathing techniques, how to strengthen your immunity. Okay. So it is already there with us. So if you can send your WhatsApp numbers, he can share it with you, or email IDs.
That will be really useful, doctor. And I think I want to open up to the forum question because it looks like I've been asking most questions. But I have a very important question before we finish. I don't think we can finish without addressing that question. But let's open up to the forum, and then I think it will help us other participants to engage as well. So if anyone has any more questions, if you can unmute and you can ask doctor questions. Srinivasan, sir, you can unmute and you can answer, please.
Sure. Thanks a lot. Thanks for this session, madam. And thanks, doctor. It's very useful for us to understand the other yoga, Tantra Yoga. I don't know whether it is possible to learn, but I will try. Doctor, this is how can we prevent cancer, doctor? Is it possible through these mudras?
Okay. So it's really a tough question, because in our traditional systems of medicine, some of the diseases we call it as karma rogas, diseases due to karma. And some incurable diseases in the ancient times, they have termed it as karma roga. Because if you have bad karma, you get this disease. But up to what extent we can believe that is a question. I have my own doubts. Even diabetes is classified as due to karma. Diabetes, leprosy. But today we are able to treat leprosy, we are able to control diabetes. Maybe in the future, with the genetic engineering, with the development of genetic engineering, we may be able to prevent diabetes or cure diabetes. So maybe in another 20 years, it may be possible. Like that, cancer is also possible. But here, what is happening in cancer scientifically? Let us forget about Tantra Yoga. What is scientifically happening in our body, every second some cells they die and new cells are produced. Catabolism and anabolism. Some destruction, continuous destruction is going on and continuous regeneration is going on. But how many is lost, they have to be replaced. If 10 cells are dead, another 10 cells should be produced. So there is a control over the production of new things. Control over how much has to be produced. That's a limiting thing. That uncontrolled proliferation of cell is called cancer. That control is lost. Genetically, that control is lost. Some genes misfired. That control is lost. So the cells, they multiply without control. That is cancer, okay? That is cancer. So what are the triggers that leads to that uncontrolled growth? We have a lot of theories. Maybe some viruses, maybe some food, maybe some poisons, radiation. So we have a lot of triggering factors and causative factors. What Tantra Yoga says, everything in the universe has a natural vibration. Everything in the universe has a natural vibration. The chair I'm sitting has a natural vibration. The table is, has a natural vibration. My physical body has a natural vibration. The earth has a natural vibration. It vibrates at a certain rate. It produces a sound, which is ultrasound. It is called a Schumann's resonance. There is science now. So earth produces a vibration. It is called Schumann's resonance. Our body has a natural vibration, the whole body. The whole body vibration is somewhere around 7.2, our frequency, 7.2. The exact frequency of the Schumann's resonance, the resonance of the earth, is 7.3. That is actually 7.26 or 27. So, almost same. As long as you live along with nature, or as long as you are tuned to the earth, the natural vibration of the earth, that is Schumann's resonance, is the same vibration of your physical body. Where the problem comes, the vibration, the natural vibration of your physical body gets distorted. It's very common. It is a reasonable, because have you heard that any musical instrument, before they play, even a violin or veena or any drums or mridanga, they have to tune it up. Because every time they play, the tuning changes. So before the next kachari, they have to tune it again. Mridanga pathina, thaddi 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 thaddi, and the kattaya tight pannuvaanga.
Yes, sir.
Veenila pathina, the screw mari irukum. Adhu pannuvaanga. Violin la adhe dhaan pannuvaanga. So you have to tune it and bring it to the original vibration. Then only the music would be good. Like that, every day our natural vibration of the physical body changes. It changes constantly. It's unavoidable. Every day it changes, but it is not dangerous. A small change in natural vibration will not produce any harm. But if it is, the change is very drastic, beyond a certain limit. ஒரு சின்ன சுருதி பேதம் இருந்ததுன்னா அந்த மியூசிக்கல் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட்ல யூ மே நாட் ஃபைண்ட் தி டிஃபரன்ஸ். பட் ஸ்ருதி ரொம்ப மாறி போச்சுன்னா அபஸ்வரம் தான் வரும். அதே தான் டிசீசஸ். வென் யுவர் பேசிக் வைப்ரேஷன், யுவர் நேச்சுரல் வைப்ரேஷன் சேஞ்சஸ் பியாண்ட் அ சர்டன் லிமிட், யூ டெவலப் ஆல் சார்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் டிசீசஸ் இன்க்ளூடிங் கேன்சர். ஸோ ப்ரிவென்ஷன் ஆஃப் கேன்சர் or prevention of any chronic disease for that matter is very simple if you maintain the natural vibration of your body. Okay? And Tantra Yoga, we have that mantra, the third one I said. First one is Tantra, second one is Yendra, third one is Mantra. That's the most powerful technique. We have mantras to bring back the natural vibration of the body. Every day the natural vibration scatters or it changes. You have to bring back the natural vibration. You have to tune your body every day. Then Tantra goes even further. We have tuning mantras for each and every part of your body. For your eye, for your nose, your ear, your tongue, your mouth, your stomach, your heart, even your kidney. So each and every part of your body we have a tuning mantra. So it's very simple. Anyone know what is the tuning mantra for heart? Because that's the most common disease now. For some time let us forget about cancer.
Is it Gayatri mantra or Dhanvantri mantra? Doctor, sorry, I don't know.
Dhanvantri mantra is disease preventing or disease curing mantra. That's a common mantra. Dhanvantri is for the father of Ayurveda. So, I'm not talking about that because the Gayatri, Dhanvantri, there are a lot of mantras are there. But it's a little difficult to practice because it has to be taught by a guru and you have to get teacher and other things. Otherwise, Gayatri is not very effective. But here it's very simple. In the treatment wise, it's very simple. We don't insist on diksha or anything. Just bija mantras. These tuning mantras are just bija mantras. Bija is like a seed. Seed mantras. Just two words or three words. Just bija mantras. Just by chanting the bija mantra, you can tune up each and every part of your body. If you keep your natural vibration, or if you tune your body every day, you will not get any chronic diseases, including cancer. And you will have peace of mind, you will have a good sleep, and you will be intelligent. Your memory will last forever, and you may not get affected with the dementia.
Thanks a lot, Doctor.
Yeah, dementia is a very big problem.
Yeah.
Dementia and Parkinson's. Lot of cases. I'm seeing a lot of cases of Parkinson's in India.
Yeah.
But during the past 10 or 15 years, the incidence of Parkinson's has doubled or tripled. Dementia, senile dementia has doubled.
Yeah.
So it's a very big problem now.
So which mantra is good for that, Doctor? Is it like... Which mantra is good for that? Is it Varagi mantra they are saying? No, Varagi, that bijam, that sound also is coming in that. Or Shri, I couldn't even recollect the name.
Varagi mantra is a longer mantra. But each and every longer mantra will have a bijam, one or two bijams in it. So, we have, for treatment purpose, for prevention or treatment, we use only the bijam. For example, that natural vibration, your natural vibration of the body, that is 7.2. Okay. The natural vibration of the earth is 7.3. Almost same. So you have to tune yourself to the vibration of the earth. That is the basic principle. But your human ear cannot hear that 7.2 vibration. That is ultrasound. It is not in the audible range. 7.2 frequency is not at all in the audible range. You cannot hear below 20 decibels. Below 20 frequency, you cannot hear the sound. Maybe the dogs can hear the sound.
Yeah.
Not humans. Humans cannot hear that sound.
Yes, Doctor,
that's
right.
I'm hearing the sound of Earth's vibration. Schumann's resonance, we are not able to hear because it is in the inaudible range. Otherwise, everyone would be hearing a humming noise always.
Okay. Yeah, well, yeah. I just recently saw one in a documentary by Will Smith in National Geography, Doctor. He goes inside, I think, the cave or inside the hair, and they try to hear the sound where there is no sound, actually. They try to use some device for that.
With some sound devices, you can enhance it or you can change the frequency and hear. So, in Tantra Yoga, most of the thing, Tantra Yoga is a very deep science, understand that. Our ancestors know that our body vibrates with the frequency of the earth. But that frequency, you cannot hear. So, whatever mantra you chant, will not reach that frequency. Because once you chant the mantra, you will hear that mantra. That is about 20. But here, the frequency is 7.2. But there are some harmonics. If you are a music student, you will understand. Some vibrations, they go in harmony with other vibrations. Some are disharmonious, some are harmonious. So, our ancestors have found out the bijas that are harmonious to this vibration. And we have another phenomenon in neurology which is called brain entrainment. Brain entrainment. You can search in Google and you will find a lot of research on it. Brain entrainment. So what our ancestors found, when you chant Om chanting, Omkara Mantra, your body's natural vibration is brought back.
Realigns, isn't it?
Very simple. You are Shruti Chakra Mari. So every morning you get up, chant Om for 2 to 5 minutes. Not more than 5 minutes. Initially, 2 minutes is enough. You have brought back your original vibration. For heart, and incidentally, that Om vibration is for the bija for your Sahasrara, which controls your upper brain, your cerebral cortex. Cerebral cortex is responsible for your dementia and Parkinson's. And the next level of evolution will happen only in cerebral cortex. So, orekalla nariya mang adikalam.
Thanks, doctor.
You can bring your original vibration back. You can prevent Parkinson's. You can Parkinsonism. You can prevent. You can prevent dementia. You can enhance your memory. You can activate your Sahasrara. A simple mantra. Rende eduthu Om. But
thanks.
How to chant it? Anga da andha idhu irukku. And each and every mantra has a kilakam. Kilakam means the secret. Only a guru will teach that secret at a higher level.
Thank you, doctor. I think it's really reiterating that any techniques, we have to learn it properly from guru, not just bits and nuggets of it, isn't it? So it's really, I think it's just enlightening us to learn it properly. And if there are structured sessions, we would be interested. Already there are lots of numbers, phone numbers being shared, how to get in touch with you. But we have few more questions from our participants. And thank you, Srinivas, for asking such a wonderful question. Dr. Ananda, do you want to come in and do you want to ask your query, please?
Thank you, Deepa. Thank you, Doctor. Rumba, very nice presentation. என்னுடைய க்வெஸ்சன் என்னன்னா, இந்த தந்திரா பிராக்டிஸ்ல இங்கிலீஷ்ல சொல்லணும்னா ஆப்சன்டிசம் சொல்லுவோம், அதாவது பிந்துவை வெளிவிடாமல் இருத்தல், அதை பத்தி உங்களுடைய ஒப்பீனியன் என்ன? அது எந்த அளவுக்கு நமக்கு இந்த தந்திரா பிராக்டிஸ்ல யூஸ்ஃபுல்லா இருக்கும்?
I never expected the question here. Okay, anyway.
And doctor, just to add to that, my important question was around sexual practices, misconception with Tantra, associated with Tantra. I'm glad Dr. Ananda brought that question, because I don't want to wind up this session without addressing that misconception, really. Okay. Thank you.
So, Tantra, as I said, this is a life science. Okay. Tantra is a life science. It will teach you how to be healthy, how to earn well, how to achieve our goals. Don't you think sex is part of life? Sex is also part of a life, human life. So Tantra will teach you how to have better sex. Okay. But with the right partner, that is the legal partner. Okay. Tantra never encourages free sex or other things. But his question was whether Tantra advocates brahmacharya. That's the question, Dr. Anand. That was your question.
Yes, sir. Yes, doctor. That's the question.
Okay. That's the question. No. Tantra never advocates brahmacharya. Okay. So what Tantra advocates? Live your normal life. When you are happy, when you achieved everything you wanted, then come to spiritual path. Till then, be in the illarathile irundhu appra thoravarathukku va appingiradhu. Ancient rishis pathinga ellarum rishigalum rishi patrinigalum adha irundanga. Perumbalan rishigalukku rishi patrinigalum irundanga. They were living with their wife. Prachana illa. ஆனால் இவரோட கொஸ்டின் இன்னும் டீப்பானது, அந்த இஜாக்குலேஷனை stop panna by just preventing the semen getting out, can you achieve anything in Tantra Yoga? Okay. According to science, no. According to science, no. Because we know what that semen contains. We know how much protein is there, what are the constituents of a semen. And by just by preventing it from going out, what you are going to achieve? So modern science says no, absolutely nothing. You don't have any benefit. But here in Tantra Yoga, we describe about lot of energies. Kundalini is one energy. Ichcha Shakti, Kriya Shakti, Jnana Shakti, we have lot of energies. This sexual energy is one type of energy, which helps you to have good sex, okay. But if you change this energy into some other type of energy, basic science says energy could neither be created nor destroyed. That is basic physics. You cannot create energy, you cannot destroy energy.
But it can be transformed.
Transformed into some other form. So, that sexual energy we have, we cannot destroy it. That is natural. That is physiological. So, up to a certain age, that sexual energy will be with you. If you resist that energy, the forced brahmacharya, it leads to a lot of other problems. Mostly, it leads to depression. Even some types of maniac problems. So mostly depression. People end up with a depression. People who are deprived of sex, good sex, they end up with a depression. But Tantra Yoga says, there's no need. But once you reach a certain age, once you decide to go into the Thuravara, that is sannyasi path, எப்ப சந்யாசம் போகணும்னு முடிவெடுக்கிறீங்களோ, ஒன்ஸ் யூ ஆர் ரெடி டு கெட் அவுட் ஆஃப் யுவர் ஹவுஸ், இந்த இல்லற வாழ்க்கையை விட்டு துறவர வாழ்க்கைக்கு போகணும் முடிவெடுத்தா, தென் யூ டிரான்ஸ்மியூட் தி செக்ஷுவல் எனர்ஜி இன்டு ஸ்பிரிச்சுவல் எனர்ஜி. தெர் ஆர் மெனி டெக்னிக்ஸ் டு டிரான்ஸ்மியூட் திஸ் எனர்ஜி. யூ கேன் டிரான்ஸ்ஃபார்ம் திஸ் எனர்ஜி. செக்ஷுவல் எனர்ஜி வுட் பி தேர், but you transform it into spiritual energy. So instead of physical ecstasy, you will have spiritual ecstasy. Just imagine at the time of climax, you get that high, that is ecstasy. What is Paramanandam? Same thing. So Paramanandam and sexual ecstasy are not two different things. Both are same, but here it is associated with physical pleasure. But that Paramananda, that Anandam Paramanandam solrame, when you have that spiritual ecstasy, it is not the physical body. Your senses are dull, you don't feel anything in your physical body, but your mind and emotions, your brain, it is in the Ananda state. That is the Brahmananda. When you transmute your sexual energy into spiritual energy. But just by preventing the semen from escaping, it's not going to help you. And brahmacharyam as such, we don't insist on, and we don't advise also, till you are, you know, illara vaalkai. So when you decide to go for a sannyasi path, then it is necessary. Okay.
Very well put through answer. Sexual, physical or sexual ecstasy to spiritual ecstasy. That's a very powerful answer, I think. Thank you, Dr. Anand, for asking that question. And Shivakumar sir, do you want to come in, please?
Yeah, it's just a quick question. Thank you, Deepa. Thank you, Doctor, for joining us and giving you valuable time today. Just a quick question. Like Patanjali Yoga Sutras, who is the author of the yogas, Who is the author of Tantra Yoga and what advice, please? Sorry, I know you have written many books on Tantra Yoga, but...
Yes, yes. Now, Patanjali Yoga Sutra, you're talking about, I didn't get your question.
Sorry, like Patanjali Yoga Sutra, who is the master or
Patanjali,
and for yoga, for Tantra Yoga, is there any specific author who has?
Tantra Yoga, nobody knows who discovered or who. But the thing is, Tantra Yoga is not a newly invented one. Tantra Yoga, what they did was they collected all the existing knowledge, all the from previous yugas. We had so many techniques, we had developed so many techniques. And according to legend, it was Dasaratha, not Dasa, sorry, Janaka Maharaja. It was only during the Janaka Maharaja's period, they were trying to collect all the knowledge, previous knowledge, compile it, and then choose the powerful ones and teach it to everyone. Because he was a reformer, Sita's father. Janaka Maharaja, he was a reformer. And he wanted to teach this all these techniques and all this knowledge to all the caste, even for women. So he was a reformer at that time. I'll ask you one question. Ram and Sita Kalyanam, Panni Vichar Rishi, இல்ல ராமருக்கு அப்புறம் வந்து பட்டாபிஷேகம் அப்புறம் நடக்கும்போது அங்கே இருந்த ரிஷியார், அவங்க கல்யாணத்துக்கு அவர் தான் இருந்தார். அவங்க திருப்பி கானகம் போயிட்டு வந்த அப்புறம் இந்த பட்டாபிஷேகம் பண்ணும்போது இருந்த ரிஷியார்
வசிஷ்ட.
வசிஷ்டர் அங்க இருந்தாரு, ஆனா கொடுத்தது யார்?
ஜனக மகரிஷி.
இல்ல அவங்களோட ராஜு, அதாவது ஒரு ஒரு அரசருக்கும் ஒரு ராஜகுரு இருப்பாங்க இல்லையா, அவங்களோட ராஜகுருவா இருந்தது விஸ்வாமித்திரர். விஸ்வாமித்திரர் தான் அங்க வந்து இந்த பட்டத்தை சூட்டுறாரு. இப்ப எல்லா ரிஷிகளும், பெரும்பாலான ரிஷிகளும் அந்த பிராமண குலத்துல இருந்து வந்தவங்க. விஸ்வாமித்திரர், விஸ்வாமித்திரர் சத்ரியர். அப்ப நமக்கு தெரிஞ்ச புராணங்கள்ல வரக்கூடிய ஒரே சத்ரிய குரு வந்து, ராஜகுரு வந்து விஸ்வாமித்திரர். அதனாலதான் மத்தவங்க எல்லாம் அவர் மேல ரொம்ப பராமப்பட்டதாகவும் அவரை கவுக்கிறதுக்கு சதி பண்ணது எல்லாமே வருது. ஓகே, விஸ்வாமித்திரருக்கு இன்னொரு பட்டம் உண்டு, பிரம்ம ரிஷி. வசிஷ்டர் வாயால் பிரம்ம ரிஷி அப்படின்னு பட்டம் கொடுத்தது விஸ்வாமித்திரர். ஓகே, அப்ப பிரம்ம ஞானத்தை கத்துக் கொடுக்கிறவரு விஸ்வாமித்திரர், சரியா? முதல்ல ஒரு குழந்தை ஒரு குருகிட்ட போய் கணக்குல இருந்து, லாங்குவேஜ்ல இருந்து, வில்வித்தையில இருந்து எல்லாத்தையும் கத்து முடிச்சப்புறம் கடைசி ஞானம் பிரம்ம ஞானம். அந்த பிரம்ம ஞானத்தை கத்துக்கணும்னா அவன் விஸ்வாமித்திரருக்கு தான் வரணும். அப்ப பிரம்ம ஞானம்னா என்ன? யாராவது சொல்லுங்களேன்,
பிரம்மத்தை பற்றியான ஞானம் இது. பிரம்மத்தை பற்றின ஞானம், பிரம்மம் என்ன என்ன, அது கடவுள் கிடையாது. பிரம்மம்ன்றது வந்து கடவுள் இல்ல, ஆனா அப்படி அப்படி வந்து
கொஞ்சம்
அது தோன்றல், எப்படி இந்த இது வந்தது அப்படின்ற, பிரம்மமும் கடவுளும் சிவனும் அந்த அந்த இதுல போல, ஆனா எனர்ஜி கிரியேஷன், ஆல் சார்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் எனர்ஜி.
சோ அந்த பிரம்மம் கிரியேட் பண்ணதுல தி மோஸ்ட் வண்டர்ஃபுல் திங் இஸ் தி ஹியூமன் பாடி. பிரம்மம் வந்து நிறைய கிரியேட் பண்ணாரு, நிறைய உயிரினங்களை படிச்சாரு. அதுல அவர் கடைசியா படிச்ச ஹையஸ்ட் ஃபார்ம் ஆஃப் இது வந்து, இஃப் யூ பிலீவ் இன் கிரியேட்டிவிட்டி தியரி, எவல்யூஷன் தியரி இல்லாம கிரியேட்டிவிட்டி பைபிள்ல வர மாதிரி இல்லை புராணங்களில் வர மாதிரி கடவுள் அப்படியே படைச்சார்னு நினச்சிங்கன்னா அப்போ மேன் இஸ் தி ஹையஸ்ட் ஃபார்ம் ஆஃப் கிரியேஷன். அப்போ பிரம்ம ஞானம் என்பது அந்த காலத்து அனாட்டமி அண்ட் ஃபிசியாலஜி. அதை ஏன் விஸ்வாமித்திரர்கிட்ட கொடுத்தாருன்னு யோசிச்சு பாருங்க, கொஞ்சம் யோசிங்கன்னா விட கிடைச்சோம். ஏன் விஸ்வாமித்திரர்கிட்ட மட்டும் பிரம்ம ஞானி, மற்றவங்கெல்லாம் ஏன் இல்லை? ஏன்னா அந்தணர்கள் நான்வெஜ் சாப்பிட மாட்டாங்க. அதிகாலத்தில் சாப்பிட்ருக்கலாம், இந்த காலத்தில் விஸ்வாமித்திரர் இவங்க இருந்த காலத்தில் அவங்க சாப்பிடலை. அப்போ அவன் ஆட்டையும் வெட்டலை, மாட்டையும் வெட்டலை, கோழியும் வெட்டலை. உள்ளே என்ன இருக்குன்னு அவனுக்கு தெரியாது. ஆனால் நான்வெஜ் சாப்பிட்றவன் அந்த காலத்தில் வீட்டில் தானே கோழி வாங்கியா இருப்போம், இப்போ தான் கடையில் ஃபேக்டாக வருது. ஒரு 30 வருஷத்துக்கு முன்னாடி என்னோடய பெரிய பையன் குழந்தையாக இருந்தப்போ எல்லாமே சாப்பிடுவான். அதுலேயும் அவனுக்கு சிக்கன் சாசேஜ் வந்து ரொம்ப பிடிக்கும், சலாமி வரைக்கும் சாப்பிடுவான். ஒரு நாள் மார்க்கெட்டுக்கு போனப்போ நானும் ஒரு அப்பான் கூட வந்துட்டான், அங்கே அந்த மட்டனை தொங்க விட்டுருந்தாங்க. பக்கத்தில் ஒரு கடையில் சிக்கனை தொங்க விட்டுருந்தாங்க, எல்லாம் உரிச்சு உரிச்சு தொங்க விட்டுருந்தாங்க. இது என்ன பண்ணால் சிக்கன், சிக்கனா? அப்போ சாசேஜ் இதில் இருந்தால் வருது அப்படின்னா, ஆமாப்பா அப்படின்னு அன்னைக்கு விட்டா நான் வச்சு. அவ்வளோனால அவன் என்ன நினச்சிட்டு இருந்தான், சாசேஜ்னா ஃபேக்ட்ரியில் ஏதோ பேக் பண்ணி வருது போல இருக்கு, ஃபேக்ட்ரியில் ஏதோ ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ணி வருது அப்படின்னு. அப்போது இந்த நான்வெஜ் சாப்பிடாதவனுக்கு அந்த அறுத்து பார்க்குற அந்த வாய்ப்பு இல்லை. நான்வெஜ் சாப்பிட்றவன் அவன் வீட்டில் அவன் தான் அதை அறுத்தாகணும், அவன் தான் அதை டிசெக்ட் பண்ணி ஆகணும், அதுதான் அவன் வெட்டி ஆகணும். அப்போ தே ஹாவ் தி நாலெட்ஜ் ஆஃப் இன்னர் பார்ட்ஸ். அடுத்தது போர்க்களத்துக்கு போகும்போது சத்திரியன் தான் போர்க்களத்துக்கு போவான். அந்த காலத்து போரில் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா எல்லாம் வெட்டு குத்து எல்லாமே வாழும் ஈட்டியும், மண்டை பிழந்தவன், வயிறு பிழந்தவன், நெஞ்சு பிழந்தவன், அந்த பேட்டில் ஃபீல்டு ஃபுல்லாக பாடிஸ் கிடக்கும். அப்போ அந்த பேட்டில் ஃபீல்டில் போகும்போது எவ்ரிபடி நோஸ் வாட் இஸ் இன்சைட். ஒரு நெஞ்சு பழந்தவனுக்கு உள்ளே பார்க்கும்போது அங்கே ஹார்ட் தெரியும், லங்ஸ் தெரியும். வயிறு பழந்தவனை பார்க்கும்போது அங்கே எவ்ரி பார்ட் ஹி வில் நோ. ஸோ ஒரு சத்ரியனுக்கு தான் அந்த நாலெட்ஜ் இருக்க முடியுமே தவிர அந்த காலத்தில் அந்த அந்தணர்களுக்கு அந்த நாலெட்ஜ் இருக்கலை. அப்போ அந்த ப்ராக்டிக்கல் நாலெட்ஜ் இருந்த ஒரே ரிஷி பிரம்ம ரிஷி, யார்? விஸ்வாமித்திரர். அதனால்தான் விஸ்வாமித்திரருக்கு பிரம்ம ரிஷிங்கிற பட்டம், அவர் கற்றுக் கொடுத்தது பிரம்ம ஞானம். இட் இஸ் நத்திங் பட் ஏன்ஷியன் அனாட்டமி அண்ட் ஃபிசியாலஜி ஆஃப் தி ஃபிசிக்கல் பாடி. ஓகே, ஆனால் பிரம்ம ஞானம் அதுக்கும் மேலே உள்ளது. ஃபிசிக்கல் பாடி மட்டும் இல்லை, வி ஹாவ் அ மைண்ட், வி ஹாவ் அ எனர்ஜி பாடி, அதை பற்றி எல்லா ஞானமும் தான் பிரம்ம ஞானம். ஓகே, வேற எதுவும் எதோ க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ்?
Shivakumar sir, unga question was answered or?
Yeah, I mean, I think so, because it's compilation from various authors rather than
authors. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Wonderful Christmas and New Year.
Later on, Shivakumar sir, give another explanation. There is an ancient text. Okay, yeah. Adhikaprama, என்னைக்கு இந்த புத்த மதம் இந்தியாவில் கொஞ்சம் ஃபேமஸ் ஆக ஆரம்பிச்சதோ அப்போ வந்து புத்திஸ்ட் மாங்ஸ் அவங்க தான் இந்த பழைய தந்திரயோக புக்ஸ் எல்லாம் ப்ரிசர்வ் பண்ணாங்க. அது ப்ரிசர்வ் பண்ணதோடு மட்டும் இல்லாமல் தே டெவலப் தேர் ஓன் டெக்னிக்ஸ் புத்த தந்திராஸ். தர் ஆர் லாட் ஆஃப் புத்த தந்திராஸ். இப்போ இதில் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா நம்ம இப்போ பண்ணக்கூடிய தந்திரயோக ப்ராக்டிசஸ் அதில் மேபி அரவுண்ட் 30% ஃப்ரம் தி புத்திஸ்ட். அங்கேருந்து நம்ம அடாப்ட் பண்ணிக்கிட்டு அங்கேருந்து அடாப்ட் பண்ண புத்திஸ்ட் தந்திரா, அதே தந்திரா வந்து ஜப்பான்லேயும் ப்ராக்டிஸ் பண்ணுறாங்க, சீனாலையும் பண்ணுறாங்க. மேபி அதுக்கு பேர் வேறையா இருக்கும், ஆனால் ப்ராக்டிசஸ் சேம். இப்போ ஷீஹாங்கில் அவங்க பண்ணுறது, நம்ம இதில் பண்ணுறது, தந்திரயோகாவில் பண்ணுறதும் ஷீஹாங்கில் பண்ணுறதும் கிட்டத்தட்ட ஒன்றாவது நம்ம ப்ராக்டிஸ். They have a lot of interactions. So we have adapted many things from the Buddhist also, later on. அதுக்கப்புறம் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா இது ரெண்டாக பிரிஞ்சுது. தந்திர யோகத்தில் வந்து ஒரு ரெண்டு பிரிவு, ஒன்று வந்து காஷ்மீரி சைபர்ஸ். அந்த காஷ்மீரி சைபர்கள் அவங்க வந்து தே டெவலப்ட் அனதர் வே ஆஃப் தந்திரா. அந்த இன்னொன்று வந்து பெங்கால் அண்ட் பீகார் அந்த ஏரியாவில் இருந்த சைவர்கள் வந்து அவங்க இது இன்னொரு பிரான்ச்சாக கொண்டு போவாங்க. அப்போ அந்த காஷ்மீர சைவச தந்திர யோகாவுக்கு வந்து ஆதர் வந்து அபினவ குப்தா அவரோட இதுதான் நிறைய இருக்கும். சாரி மச்சேந்திரநாத் சார், அதுங்க வந்து காஷ்மீரி சைவஸ் வந்து மச்சேந்திரநாத், இந்த பீகார் அண்ட் பெங்கால் வந்து அபினவ் குப்தா. அப்போ அது ரெண்டாக பிரிஞ்சது. இப்போ நான் டீச் பண்ணுற எல்லாமே வந்து மச்சேந்திரநாத்தோட அந்த லினேஜ் காஷ்மீரி சைவிசம். அதில் வந்து புத்திஸ்ட் இது நிறைய இருக்கும். நம்ம இந்த பெங்கால் பீகாரில் உள்ளதில் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா புத்திஸ்ட் இது கொஞ்சம் கம்மியாக இருக்கும். அது அபினவ் குப்தாவோட அந்த பிரான்ச், அதில் புத்திஸ்ட் இது கம்மியாக இருக்கும். இன்னும் கொஞ்சம் இந்தியன் வேர்ஷன் இன்னும் கொஞ்சம் ஜாஸ்தியாக இருக்கும். கொஞ்சம் க்ரூடான ப்ராக்டிசஸ் நிறைய இருக்கும். லேட்டரானது எப்படி பிரித்தோம் அப்படின்னா வாமாச்சாரம், தட்சிணசாரம், கௌலசாரம். இப்போ வாமாச்சாரம் அப்படின்னா இப்போ இட்ஸ் மோஸ்ட்லி இட்ஸ் பாப்புலர் இன் பெங்கால் அண்ட் பீகார். பெங்கால் பீகார் கொஞ்சம் மத்திய பிரதேஷ் இந்த ஏரியாவில் வந்து வாமாச்சாரம் இஸ் வெரி பாப்புலர். அந்த வாமாச்சாரத்தோட இது கேரளாலையும் பாப்புலராக இருக்கு. இங்கே என்ன அப்படின்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா தேர் ஏம் இஸ் டு கெட் தி பவர்ஸ், சித்திகள், அதை வச்சு பணம் பண்ணுறது. சித்திகளை வச்சுட்டு மந்திர வித்தியெல்லாம் இது பண்ணுவேன், அதனால தான் அந்த மண்டை ஓடு வச்சுட்டு இது படையிறது, மயானத்தில் போய் பூஜை பண்ணுறது, இதெல்லாம் வந்து அவங்களோட வேலை. இங்கே வந்து ஞானம் தேவையில்லை. தே டீச் ஒன்லி தி டெக்னிக்ஸ். ஸோ எனி ஒன் கேன் லேர்ன். படிப்போ இல்லை ஞானமோ தேவையில்லை, அறிவு தேவையில்லை. மனப்பாடம் பண்ண தெரிஞ்சால் போதும். டெக்னிக்கை சொன்ன டெக்னிக்கை ஏன் எதுக்குன்னு கேட்காம பண்ணுனா சிவில் அச்சீவ். அவன் வந்து சின்சியராக உட்காந்து அவன் பண்ண ஆரம்பித்தானா தேவில் அச்சீவ் many things. நிறைய பவர்ஸ் வரும், நிறைய இதெல்லாம் வரும். அது வாமாச்சாரம். ஓகே, அங்கே வந்து ஞானத்துக்கு இடம் கிடையாது. இன்னொன்று வந்து தட்சிணசாரம், இட்ஸ் மோர் ஞான ஓரியன்ட். இதை நம்ம டீச் பண்ணுறது. இது வந்து மசேந்திரநாத்தோட சைவ அந்த காஷ்மீர் சைவசம் அந்த லீனேஜ். ஸோ இதில் வந்து நிறைய புத்திஸ்ட் இதுவும் இருக்கும். ஃபார் எவ்ரி ப்ராக்டிஸ் யூ ஹாவ் அ எக்ஸ்பிளனேஷன், ஏன் எதுக்கு எப்படி வேலை செய்யும். அது சயின்டிஃபிக்காக அதை கொண்டு போனார் மச்சேந்திரநாத். மூணாவது மார்க்கம் வந்து கௌல மார்க்கம். கௌல மார்க்கம் என்ன அப்படின்னா இட் கம்பைன்ஸ் போத். அந்த தட்சிணசாரத்தோட ஞானத்தை எடுத்துக்குது, அந்த வாமாச்சாரத்தில் இருக்கிற சில க்ரூடான மெதட்ஸையும் ஒன்று ரெண்டை அடாப்ட் பண்ணிக்கிது. அது ரெண்டையும் இணைச்சி பண்ணுறது கௌலசாரம். அப்போ இதில் வாமாச்சாரம் வந்து கீழான தந்திர யோகம் அப்படின்னு ஒதுக்கிடுறோம். ஏன்னா That only teaches about sex. Tantric sex is taught only in Vamachara. Vamachara Tantra Yoga வந்து முழுக்க முழுக்க தாந்திரிக் டெக்ஸ்ட். அதில் வந்து நம்ம பஞ்ச மகாரங்கள் அப்படின்னு சொல்லுவோம். அஞ்சு மகாரங்கள், மால ஆரம்பிக்கிற அஞ்சு வந்து மது, மாமிசம், அந்த மாதிரி அது ஒரு மச்சம். ஸோ அதில் வந்து ஒரு பூஜை பண்ணும், ஒரு தந்திர யோகா ப்ராக்டிஸ் பண்ணோம்னா அங்கே மது இருக்கணும், மாமிசம் இருக்கணும், மச்சம் இருக்கணும், ஒரு பெண் இருக்கணும், இது எல்லாமே அங்கே இருக்கணும். அந்த உடலுறவு எல்லாமே அதில் வந்துடும். இது வந்து வாமாச்சாரம். இந்த வாமாச்சார ப்ராக்டிசஸ் தான் நமக்கு வந்து தந்திர யோகனால ஒரு பயம், தந்திர யோகம்னு சொல்லணும்னா ஒரு அசூய, ஒரு ஹெசிடேஷன், இல்லை ஒரு அருவறுப்பு கூட வரும். ஏன்னா அவங்க பண்ணுற அந்த சில விஷயங்கள் அந்த மாதிரி இருக்கும். ஆனால் தட்சிணசாரம் இட்ஸ் மோர் டுவர்ஸ் ஞானம். அது வந்து சயின்ஸ் ஆஃப் விஷயம். இங்கே இந்த மாதிரி எந்த ப்ராக்டிஸும் கிடையாது. ஓகேயா, வி டோன்ட் ப்ராக்டிஸ் எனி திங் ஓரியன்ட் டு செக்ஸ். ஏன்னா அதில் பேசிக்கான விஷயம் என்னன்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா வாட் இஸ் செக்ஸ், யூனியன் ஆஃப் எ மேல் அண்ட் ஃபீமேல், தட் இஸ் செக்ஸ். மேல் அண்ட் மேல், ஃபீமேல் ஃபீமேல், அதெல்லாம் வேற கதை. பட் நார்மல் செக்ஸ் இஸ் பிட்வீன் எ மேல் அண்ட் ஃபீமேல். தட் இஸ் டூ போல்ஸ் ஆஃப் எனர்ஜி, எ பாசிட்டிவ் அண்ட் நெகட்டிவ். இப்போ வாமாச்சாரத்தில் அதை எப்படி எடுத்துக்கிறாங்கன்னா அதே அர்த்தத்தை அப்படி எடுத்துக்கிறாங்க. ஒரு ஆணும் பெண்ணும் இணைவது, அதை மைத்துனம் அப்படின்னு சொல்லுவோம். பஞ்ச மாகாரங்களில் ஒன்று மைத்துனம். ஆனால் இந்த தட்சிணசாரத்தில் அது எப்படி எடுத்துக்கிறோம்னா வி ஹாவ் எ எனர்ஜி இன்சைட், That energy has two aspects, positive and negative. That is Shiva and Shakti. So the union of Shiva and Shakti inside the body. நம்ம உடலுக்குள் இருக்கிற சிவமும் சக்தியும் இணைவது அது மைத்ரம். That is tantric sex. என் உடல்ல இருக்கக்கூடிய சக்திங்கிற அந்த ஆஸ்பெக்டும் என் உடல்ல இருக்கக்கூடிய சிவம்ங்கிற ஆஸ்பெக்டும் ஒன்றா இணையணும். தென் ஒன்லி மை சர்க்கியூட் இஸ் க்ளோஸ்ட். இப்போதான் என்னோட பாடி வந்து எஃபிஷியண்டா ஒர்க் பண்ண முடியும். இட் வில் அச்சீவ் இட்ஸ் மேக்ஸிமம் பொட்டன்ஷியல். So that is the sex aspect in Dakshinasana. We teach only that, okay?
Thank you, doctor. It's been a wonderful session. Thank you, Shivakumar sir as well for asking that question. So it has brought us more information, really. And it's been a great privilege to ask you these questions and get to know about tantric yoga. And I think we would like you again in this forum, maybe another day, because we the more we listen to you, the more we have more questions, and it's given us a bit more insight into tantric yoga. And some of the explanations you've given us have beautifully addressed some of the misconceptions as well that are associated, and not just explanation, but with evidence and listening to your knowledge of ancient literatures and how it evolved. It's been a wonderful session today. And I think I'm going to thank Thangarajan, sir, for bringing you to this forum. And thank you so much. Thangarajan Anna, irukkringla?
I would like to invite our president, Mr. Anton Gangakumaran, to give a thank note, sir. That would be more appropriate to just thank our beloved Dr. John for giving such a wonderful, vast knowledge, which actually we were seeking for the information, and he has just given in a very simplistic way. So I invite now our assistant professor, Anton Gangakumaran, to give the vote of thanks, and then we can conclude the session.
Be blessed by the divine, sir. Thank you.
Be blessed by the divine. Walta Valamnan, Dr. John Nayagam. Thiba, you have handled it very well. You did excellent job. Thangarajan for bringing this introducing Dr. Nayagam to us, to this forum. It was a surprise, but it turned out to be such an ocean of knowledge. You know, 40 years of medical practice and 20 years of Tantra Yoga. I think you are more than a teacher. You're almost like a professor, able to talk about the ocean of knowledge in such a, summarize it in a less than an hour with few questions. I was not expecting it. To be truthful, I thought it's going to be a marketing meeting, but turned out to be, it's more than a marketing meeting. And you demonstrate to us, you are certainly a professor in your knowledge. And Sivakumar and Ananda and Srinivas, you know, they are all regular doctors who continue to challenge us and bringing the science into yoga. So they always participate in our discussions. Thank you, doctor. We wish you well. Be blessed by the divine. As Deepa said, we want you to be back. Maybe we will organize a 3-hour session and with a presentation. If you see the way you break it down, because I got some very strong Kashmiri Brahmin who always bang on his chest, and he's a Kashmiri Brahmin. So now that I understood Shiva is from Kashmiri, the difference between the Bengali and Bihari. So we would like you to come back one day. We will invite you. We might get a long session, and that will give us more insight. It's not about learning Tantra or learning yoga. It's about sharing the knowledge. By sharing the knowledge, you are seeding more. You are sowing more seeds into our minds, and this particular group in London is a highly trained in their own professions, from Ananda to Srinivas to Sivakumar and Thangaraj. So they are all Thiba, is one of the best dietitian you can have it in NHS. So you are at the right place. It's a very highly fertile land of this UK Sky Meditation Center. So every seed you sow, and it's going to, certainly is going to, you are going to harvest. The harvest, when I mean, that's your pride and the benefits that we all going to gain from your knowledge is the pride you are going to achieve. It's not about money, or it's not about that. You remember, you are saying you have developed 5,000 teachers. You are going to create new teachers out of UK Sky Meditation Center. We bless you and thank you once again, wholeheartedly. I was never expecting this type of presentation. It's well beyond my imagination. Walla walla mudan. Be blessed by the divine. Thank you, Thangaraj and Jeeva and Ananda, Srinivas, Okmar, every one of them, of you, you know, to make this discussion live and take it to the next step. You know, Ananda is interested in doing an MSc in the university to be a teacher and try to organize a module. So these are the knowledges. You could be one of a visiting lecturer on that MSc module. So it's very encouraging. You know, I mean, we speak to different people. We are collecting. Hopefully, Ananda will pick it up and say, "Yeah, here is a module. I can ask John to do it for us." You know what I mean? So yes, we are. It is a it's a feeding. What do you call feeding good ideas and growing out? Thank you, Thangaraj. Thangaraj, you want to say ulaga nela
velpu? So Ananda is doing it at which university? MSc. Ananda.
Yeah.
You're doing it in which university? MSc. We were Vedantri or other universities? MSc.
Actually, Ananda is organizing it out for the Master of Science in his UK universities, which he's also one of the faculty.
Because I am giving guest lectures to Tamil Nadu Sports University, that yoga naturopathy.
Yeah, sir. So, Dr. John, to add to that one.
And now they are inviting me to that Meenakshi Medical Mission. They have started yoga, PhD yoga.
See, so, to your knowledge, Dr. John, what Ananda's position is, if you want to run Yoga for Human Excellence, and if you want to spread Vedatriyam around the world, it's better to have a UK recognized university do a module, because by doing a MSc module in one of the UK's leading universities, good. That will spread, that will have a global exposure. So he has been working with Edinburgh University, and is in the, because of the COVID is slightly delayed, but he started in the right path. Once we collected that MSc module, then it's easy for us to, Ananda's vision is to sell it to UAE and America and all over the international students, whether it could be Indians and others to join this MSc module, because having stick to an Indian university, we'll have a limited captured audience. But when you go into an international Western university, then suddenly the exposure is slightly different. So. John, we will invite you. We are in the path of way of doing it. Yes, Dr. Sakti and Ananda is working on that one, and Ananda is leading that the discussions. And we will do it. And we made a decision. Now it's be blessed by the God, blessed the divine. We will move into the right place. Hopefully, in two years' time, we'll have a module for us to sell it to the world. Sangharaj, do you want to say ulaga nela velpu?
Yes, sir. The world blessing. May the world be blessed with plenty of rain. The farmers work to produce an abundance of grain. Let practitioners of all prosper, flourish and grow, and culture progress through the need to share and grow. Let the rulers be beyond feelings of anger or fear, illiteracy, poverty, and all evils made to disappear. Let the true lamp of knowledge burn steady and bright. Our sense of duty guide us along paths always right. Be blessed by the divine. Be blessed by the divine. be blessed by the divine.